You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Political Science 101, American Institutions. My name is Brenda Riddick and I am your instructor for this class. I welcome all of you who are viewing today and I encourage you, as I will talk about throughout the program today, the opportunity to call in with your questions, comments, suggestions, perspectives, and you can do that by calling 1-800-339-1193. You can also email your questions, and we'll talk a little bit about that in just a few minutes. But you can do that at, it'll come up here in just a second. I did put a syllabus out for you, so we will have an opportunity, I think, before the class session ends today to go through that just a little bit, but I do want you to know that it is up online. You should take a look at it. You should take a very good look at it to see what all is involved in the next few weeks that we'll be spending together. The email address for you to send your questions is up on the screen right now, so you can go ahead and do that as well. And all of that information is also included in the syllabus. So I again welcome you to Political Science 101, American Institutions, and I see that I have students as far away as Porterville, Ceres, Modesto, all the way to Lodi, Redding, Shasta, all the way down to San Diego, Temecula. So I do really appreciate you guys taking the time to join me today. And well, let's just get into it. Before we actually dive into what the conversation is going to be about today, which is on politics and trying to differentiate between the terms politics and government, I do want to let you know which textbook that we are using for this course. And if you could just zero in on that textbook. It's Keeping the Republic, which is also listed on Blackboard for you and in the course syllabus as to which version you should get. What I'm working from is the fifth edition, which is the brief. Whoops, let me turn it the right way. The fifth brief edition. You can also get the fourth edition, although there were changes that were made, obviously, going to the fifth edition. And the sixth edition is out now, but it's not necessary for you to get the sixth edition as it would be a little bit more costly to do so. You can get these textbooks online through some of the rental companies, textbook rental companies, and or our bookstore, wherever it's going to be cost effective for you to secure them. You will need the textbook. What I cover with you in this class comes from the text. It comes from information we provide off of the internet. It will come from a combination of lectures, information that I will post up or have already posted up for you on Blackboard that you will find in the different sections of Blackboard, as well as contributions from the community. We'll have guest speakers from time to time that you'll have an opportunity to engage with about some of the political environment and the issues and concerns and well-being of us as citizens here in the United States. So in the coming weeks, I believe our first guest that we will have will be in just about 2 or 3 weeks on the issue of civil liberty. So I do encourage you to take a look at what's on Blackboard related to that particular topic. Be guided by the syllabus. And of course, if you have any questions, feel free to let me know as we move through the course. Okay, so I know you probably all know what politics is and what the differences are between the term politics and government. If you don't, we'll figure it out today, all right? So let me start by telling you what the learning objectives are, which are also posted on Blackboard for you. We're going to talk about the meaning of politics itself, the variety of different political systems and the roles they endorse for individuals who live under those particular rules and systems. We'll talk about the American founders' ideas around democracy and citizenship, the ideas that hold us together as a nation, and sometimes they pull us apart as well, and the ideas that define our political conflicts as such. The themes around power and citizenship that will serve as our framework for understanding American politics. What is our role as citizens in this society? And so as students, I would like to hear from you as we go through the course. Questions I'm going to pose to you, I would love to hear your responses and your answers as you critically think about what that particular question might mean to you. This is how we share perspectives. This is how we share and value opinions. So there is no such thing as a quote unquote stupid question. If you have a question, let's hear your question. If you have a comment, we're open to hearing the comments of others. That's how we gain perspective on the thoughts that we don't have ourselves because we're all different. So the value in being able to share that is really important to all of us. And I do encourage you to do so. As my welcome message indicated to you, this course is intended to engage you interactively and energetically to participate in the learning process. So I've been there, I've done it, and I'm sharing with you, and I want you to give back to me through this exchange of participation and engagement in what we're going to be learning over the next 13 weeks. Having said that, then, let's talk about, as I skip back over here to my paper. Before I tell you what I think politics is and what the textbook defines as politics, and it's really a very basic and generic definition, why don't we go ahead and take a look at the first video clip that I'm going to introduce you to. And then from that clip, you come back and tell me what your thoughts are about politics before I give you my definition. So let's take a look at the clip and then come back to me with your comments.
I don't understand politics at all.
What part don't you understand?
Well, what is politics, really?
Political scientist Harold Laswell defined politics as who gets what, when, and how.
Who gets what, when, and how? I'm afraid I don't understand.
Let's say you want something. How would you get it?
Well, I guess I would buy it.
How much will you pay for it?
I don't know. Does that matter?
Yes, because if I'm the seller, I might see that you don't have a clear idea of what price you want to pay, so I might try to charge you more, so that I gain at your expense. My gaining at your expense is part of Laswell's who gets what, when, and how.
So I should bargain, or negotiate with you.
Yes, when you want to buy something, bargaining or negotiations is how you get what you want.
But bargaining over prices? Isn't that economics?
Yes, economics and political science are very closely related.
But I thought politics was about voting and government.
What does government do?
It makes laws.
How does it make laws?
I guess it votes on them.
What do they do before they have a vote?
Well, I guess they discuss the proposed laws before they vote on them.
Pretend you are a legislator. How will you get people to vote for your proposed law if you cannot persuade them through discussion?
Well, I guess I would see if there were some changes I could make that would make them willing to vote for it.
And what do you call that process of discussing what changes you would be willing to make?
I guess I would call it negotiation. Or bargaining.
Yes, just like.
Just like when I was buying something. So is all politics about negotiations and bargaining?
Politics is about who gets what, when, and how. So it's about anything that anyone might want, and any way that they might get it. Are negotiations and bargaining the only way to get things?
No. I guess you can steal things too.
What if I try to stop you from stealing something from me? How would you manage to do it?
Maybe I could hit you on the head.
Exactly.
So violence is a form of politics too?
And what is the worst form of violence?
I suppose the worst form of violence is war.
Why do countries go to war?
I guess because there's something they want. Territory, or natural resources, or freedom.
A war is about who gets what, when, and how, through violence?
I guess so.
So is stealing something by hitting me on the head also about who gets what, when, and how, through violence?
Yes, so I guess it really is political too. So when you say politics is about who gets what, when, and how, you really mean it's about almost all of human behavior. I think I am beginning to understand.
So that just gave you a quick glimpse into what politics is from the perspective of that little video. So I would ask you, does it align with what you thought politics or the term politics means? Is it what you've experienced? It's about who gets what, when, where, and how. It's about a power. It's about authority. It's about the haves and the have-nots. It's about our economic system, the various elements of our economic system, which we'll touch on today. It's about freedom, equality, democracy. We'll talk about how our form of democracy is a little bit different than some of the types of governmental systems that we have in the world. We'll touch on some of it, but not all of it, as we'll get into the founding of the Constitution on next week, and we'll get more into why we have a democratic representative democracy here in the U.S. versus what some of the other countries might have, but we'll touch a little bit on it. But nonetheless, as the clip that you just saw, politics is about the struggle of who gets what, when, where, and how. It can be a positive struggle. It can be a negative struggle. It can be the idea of us putting voting our legislators, individuals, into legislative opportunities to make decisions for us as a representative democracy, or it can be, as the example gave in the video just now, an opportunity where people are wanting something, but they don't necessarily get it in the manner that they would like to, and so they end up fighting for it or taking it away from something or someone. And then that becomes a tug of war. It becomes a war, if you will. It becomes a takeaway of, well, I didn't have it today, but I want it. This is how I'm going to get it. It may not be the right way to do it, but it's got power. It's got authority in it. It's got the haves and the have-nots. So shaping that definition, then, we can say that politics, again, is the struggle for power and resources in society and about who gets what, when, where, and how. Okay? All right. We can use the tools that we gain from politics in this political environment to allocate scarce resources. And we do that through distributive policy, redistributive policy, and determining how, when money comes in, how it's going to go back out, who's going to get what, how much of it they will get. There's a lot of decision making around the politics of that, which leads us into the economy or the economics of the situation. But before I get down that road to the economics, I do want to talk about this idea of power. I'm not sure what your definition of power is, but again, power can be used in a positive way or in a detrimental way. So as long as we're working towards the goal, a common goal for everyone, that power is to be used legitimately, then we're okay. When we have issues where it's not used in legitimate terms, then we have problems. Power is the ability to get others to do what you want. So you can yield it, weld it, you can push it out there, you can do it in a manner in which you actually get individuals to do what it is that you want. And from a government standpoint, it mostly works. In many cases, it has over the centuries. In other cases, it doesn't work, which again goes back to why we have had wars over time, why we have had disagreements between ourselves in this society. How power is managed must be therefore legitimate and or it will be violent. We don't want the violent unless there is a reason for shaping a change. That change then manifests itself into something that's positive for the greater whole. It is shaped by politics and it helps provide the rules and institutions that turn, in turn, continue to shape the political process. And we'll define some of these ideas, these labels, if you will, like the term institutions, which is tied to our course, American institutions. So we'll talk about that in a minute. A government then, different from politics, government is a system of organizations or exercising authority over a body of people. So we have this representative bureaucracy, this representative democracy, where we elect individuals to represent us, and then they do things for the greater whole, for the masses of us in this society in the United States. and they have the authority to do what it is that they need to do at the federal level. And then as we get into the Constitution next week, we'll define more specifically the powers for each set, federal, state, and how they're divided. But nonetheless, they have the authority over a body of people, the people being us, the citizens of the United States. All right, so as I've explained a little bit of that, and I'm still waiting to hear from some of you, let's look at, well, before I get there, let's talk about rules. I've talked about power. I've talked about rules and authority. So rules are rules. You have them in your homes. You have them in school. You have them in all walks of society and all walks of life. If we didn't have rules, and what are rules? Rules are directives. They give us guidance. They tell us what it is that we can and cannot do legally. And we don't want to go outside of those rules, although we do have individuals that are rule breakers. And sometimes it benefits to go outside of the rules, but you have to be careful about what the outcomes might look like. So what would this society look like, for instance, if we didn't have rules in place to guide us in the things that we do on a daily basis? If we didn't know, for instance, where to go for certain services, certain agencies, certain departments, certain institutions of government in the public area, even in the private sector, where would we know to go or how would we know to get there? Who do we talk to? What are the hours? What do they provide? What are the parameters by which we can obtain these services? We have rules and regulations for everything. If we didn't, it'd be a very chaotic environment because we would all have our own way of thinking. We would have our own way of deciding what would be in our own self-interest that may not necessarily serve the interests of others. So rules are here for a reason. Again, we may not like all of them, but we have to work within the confine of those rules. So having said that, then let's go ahead and take a look at this next video, which talks about politics and government, and give me your thoughts on and what you see. And before we go to that clip, I wanna let you know that these broadcasts are archived, so if you wanna go back and look at any of these videos after today's live broadcast, feel free to do so. Go ahead and you can do that by going to youtube.com / CSUDHTV, where we have all of our courses, TV courses, archived for your viewing at a later time. All right, so let's go ahead and switch over to the video. You guys let me know what you think about this one.
It's the rallying cry of the Occupy Wall Street protesters. They say that a tiny minority controls America's wealth. So, how rich have the richest got? And how poor are the rest of us? Is it really 99% versus 1%? The richest 1% of the U.S. population? They own a third of U.S. net worth. So how did we get here? When times were good, everyone gained. In Bill Clinton's boom of 1993 to 2000, average incomes went up, just as they did during George W. Bush's boom at the beginning of his presidency. But if you were rich, you gained even more. That's nearly half of all the growth in the Clinton boom years. Under George W. Bush, it was even more. And there are some really rich people in the U.S. today. In fact, there are now over 3.1 million millionaires. But these are not the richest of all. The U.S. has over 400 billionaires, more than any other country in the world. Who's at the top of that pile? These three have a combined net worth of $131 billion. That's just over the combined budget shortfall of every state in the U.S. for 2011. More than the cost of the global war on terror in 2010. But haven't the rich lost out as well as the poor in the economic crash? When the economy tanked, everyone suffered. In 2010, the average American earned $26,487, down over $2,000 in real terms on 2006. If you were poor, it's been an even bigger drop. The 24 million least wealthy households in America saw their average income go down by 10%. If you were super rich, it went down too. the 400 wealthiest American households lost around 4%, including inflation. That's down to an average of $270.5 million per household. So the richest lost 4%. The poorest lost 10%. Part of the reason average Americans have been hit so hard is where their wealth comes from. Before the crash, middle-class Americans had 65% of their wealth tied up in their house. But the richest 1% of the population kept most of their wealth in stocks and shares and business. So, when house prices went south, many Americans found their wealth disappearing too. Now, one in every seven Americans lives below the poverty line. That's a record 46.2 million people. One in six Americans have no health insurance. That's 50 million people. Of every 17 Americans, at least one will be earning below the minimum wage of $7.25 per hour. 14.5% of American households are defined as food insecure. That means for every seven households, one will have trouble putting enough food on the table. But some things are doing very well. Sales of luxury cars are up. Big luxury brands have reported their best sales figures in years. Tiffany Jewelers up. Brands like Louis Vuitton and Givenchy, brands like Gucci, Yves Saint Laurent, and Porsche. And America's top executives are paying themselves very well, too. It is down, but still pretty good. $4.9 million each in the latest figures. And a Washington Post investigation found the following. Since the 1970s, median pay for executives at the nation's largest companies has more than quadrupled, even after adjusting for inflation, according to researchers. Over the same period, pay for a typical non-supervisory worker has dropped more than 10%. But don't the super rich pay taxes? They do. Just not quite so much as the rest of us. If you earn between $100,000 and $200,000, you will be paying up to 25% effective tax rate, and that's before payroll taxes kick in. The 400 richest tax returns surveyed by the IRS paid just 18.1% in 2008. And it's got better for them. In 2001, as George W. Bush became president, that rate was 23%. So is it 99% versus 1%? The richest 1% of the U.S. population own a third of U.S. net worth. But an even smaller group, the 0.01% of the population, are at a record high. In fact, is it really 99.99% versus 0.01%? So where do you fit? Are you one of the 99.99% or one of the 0.01%?
So where do you fit? I know I'm not part of that 1%, so I know I'm not up there with the three top individuals who combined $131 billion. Wow, that's a lot of money. Maybe the crowdfund might be an idea. I don't know. Maybe I should look into that. Anyway, give me your thoughts on that. That was a lot of statistical information there, a lot of data that was provided to you about what it looks like from an economic standpoint, just at a very high level for us here in the United States. And maybe you can just share with me your thoughts so we can talk about it in addition to what I have to share with you around the economics of politics. So having segue into that, politics is different from economics. So politics is different from government, and politics is different from economics. Economics then is the system for distributing society's wealth. That particular video that you saw gave you just a slight indication of how the overall wealth is distributed, but not as much detail as we will get into in a few weeks. But nonetheless, economic systems vary in how much control government has over what that distribution looks like and how it takes place. So ranging from different types of capitalistic economies, you can look at a capitalistic economy or what we call a regulated capitalism, which is what we have here in the United States, where the free market actually reigns, but government may provide procedural guarantees, and the rules are fair. And to a socialistic economy, it's a little bit different, where government makes significant guarantees of what they can hold to be fair distributions of personal wealth or material resources or personal wealth. So let's break that down just a little bit. Social democracy in middle or market economy aims to fulfill some of these substantive goals. And economic systems really do vary in how much control government has over the economy itself. So political systems vary on how much control government has on us as individuals. And there are different types of systems that we're going to talk about. They range from totalitarian governments, where authoritarian government might have more substantive decisions about how lives are lived and the social order and how the social order is actually arranged, to all the way to the other extreme, which is anarchy, where there is no control over things at all. So short of anarchy then is what we consider democracy, based on popular sovereignty, where individuals have considerable individual freedom, we like to believe so anyway, and the social order provides fair processes rather than specified outcomes. So what does all of that mean? All right, well, let's take a look. From an authoritarian system or authoritarian type of government, which I talked about earlier, it might be a monarchy, a theocracy, could be a fascist type of government, or an oligarchy. People who live in such systems are actually subjects. So they can't really claim anything. Government owns everything. They can't claim anything against the government, therefore. So it's a little bit different than the idea of what we have in the United States is called democracy. So let me break it down even further and tell you that authoritarian systems, an example would be like a fascist government where policy is made for the ultimate glory of the state. And a direct example of that would be Nazi Germany. Oligarchy, type of authoritarian system of government then, is ruled by a very small group of elites. Elites who have the power, elites who are wealthy, elites who make the rules and regulations about what is going to happen with the citizens within their realm. Totalitarian governments, again, under the authoritarian systems of government. Well, it's a system in which absolute control is exercised over every aspect of life. So can you think of any countries where that might be the case? One comes to mind for me, and that would be North Korea. Are there any others that you guys can think of that might fall into that particular category of a system in which all control is handled or done with by the actual ruler, dictator? Okay. Hi, Sarah. Sarah says, I believe I am the lesser percent. You might be, Sarah. I'm sure there are many out there who believe that we know that we're not part of that 1%, and we might want to be a little bit part of it. I know I would, but we're far from it. And so why does that kind of situation exist? And there are those who would say, well, they put their boots to the ground and they worked really hard and they earned what they got, so why shouldn't they be able to keep it? And there are others who say, well, that's true. Does that mean that they don't contribute to society economically in some way that benefits the greater whole? Well, I'm sure that they do, but as you heard in the clip, they may not necessarily have to pay the same type of taxes in the tax structure that the rest of us who don't make that 1% have to pay. But they do a lot of things with their money, and I'm sure you guys can explore some of the things that Warren Buffett does that benefits society, or Bill Gates does that benefits society, or the Walton family does that benefits society, or some of the others that are in the top 1%. Is it their fault that they make money and are doing so well and some of us can't seem to get off the ground? I guess the timing was right and everything aligned for them. And not to make a joke of the situation, these folks did work hard for their money, and many of us would like to have a small portion or piece of the pie. So from a distribution standpoint, a wealth distribution standpoint, is the wealth equally distributed across the country? Is the wealth equally distributed when you have homelessness, when you have people living in the streets, when you have children who are homeless, living in cars or on the street, in shelters? Is the wealth equally distributed? And not just to pick on these three guys, but I mean from all of us. From a perspective of food insecurities for the elderly or food insecurities for individuals who are impoverished and just don't have enough money and have to make decisions about whether or not they're going to pay the gas and electric bill or the rent to keep a roof over their head for their families or themselves. This is America. So from a wealth distribution standpoint, from an economic standpoint, we are granted the opportunity to be a capitalistic society. But comes along with that comes responsibility. And so a lot of the responsibility that we give to that, we can manage some of that on ourselves as individuals, and another piece of that is managed by the government. So people are concerned about the fairness in how wealth is distributed. People are concerned about our tax rates and how people are taxed for the income that they have. Do they have enough to live off of as a living wage based on what the end result is after all taxes and deductions are taken out? Is it enough for them to sustain their families and their livelihoods? We could go way down the rabbit hole in this conversation. So thank you, Sarah, for your comment. I appreciate that. All right, so let me get back to then the other types of government. We have non-authoritarian systems, and the anarchy falls into this particular kind. And a government with an anarchy is the absence of government and laws. It's a free-for-all. You just go out there and do your thing. It's a coup. You take over, and there's no rules and regulations. Everybody gets to do what they want. Now, how would that look here in the United States? What would society look like to you if we lived in an anarchist type of environment? Would we not be going after each other? Would we not be, or would it be the opposite? We would just all be quite happy-go-lucky individuals, and everything is just fine, and the world works in the proper order that it should, and we don't have any problems because there's no rules and regulations to guide us. Democracy. Democracy is what we have here in the U.S. Government that, again, vests its power in the people based on popular sovereignty. So we, again, have a representative democracy where we elect individuals to represent our needs as a constituency, where they go, and we'll talk about Congress in a couple of weeks, where we, and not just Congress, in our own states and our own local government agencies, we elect individuals to represent our concerns and our needs, and hope that that is done in a fair and equitable manner to serve not just their individual interests, but the collective interests of the people that put them in those individual places of power to make decisions about our society. So popular sovereignty, I've thrown that word out a couple times. That's the concept that citizens are the ultimate source of political power. And how do we exercise that ultimate source of political power? I ask you guys. So I'll come back to that question in a few minutes. How do we exercise this idea of us as citizens holding the political power in this type of government, in a democratic sovereignty, popular sovereignty? All right, there are some theories around democracy that we're going to touch on, and elite democracy. It limits the citizens' role to choosing among competing leaders that have already been predetermined. Then you have the pluralist democracy, which is citizen membership in groups is the key to political power for these individuals. Participatory democracy. Citizens should actively and directly control all aspects of their lives and vote directly on all legislation. We don't have that. We don't have that in full. Participatory democracy, I'm a huge advocate of individuals exercising their opportunity to vote, exercising their opportunity to engage at a local level, at a community level, at a state level, with the individuals that are making decisions about their lives, with the individuals that are making decisions about, again, minimum wage or taxes or food, regulatory items, agencies that have the power to make the rules and decisions and policies that affect all of us. But how do we do that if we're silent? How do we do that if we stand by and let others take care of it for us because we put them in there? Excuse me, we sent them to these individual places, to whether it be the state of Sacramento, I'm sorry, the state of California up in Sacramento, or whether it be Washington, D.C., wherever it is that, or even in our own local governments, wherever it is that we're voting in individuals to represent us, are we standing by and just letting them do what we think they're going to do or we want them to do? How are we holding them accountable for actually doing it? How do we exercise through a participatory process the idea and the notion of us sharing in this governance of what goes on here in the U.S.? We elect people to represent us. We send them off to go do their work. Do we follow up and keep track of what it is that they've done? Do we keep track of the promises that they made when they were running for the position? When things don't go well or they don't seem to look right, do we go back and challenge? Or do we just let it go until the next election cycle? Or do we say, well, they'll handle it. It's not my problem. Or somebody else will take up the cause. I'm not going to be bothered with it. Or I don't have time. Those are some of the more common excuses that we give for not participating in government. I'd like to see that change. I'd like to see us at some level, whether it be writing, and I know we have electronics, and we've gotten away from the skill of writing in many instances, but writing a letter to your legislator. Maybe I'll make that one of our assignments. I don't know. But writing a letter to your legislator, letting them know that you're concerned about something or you'd like them to consider something or have they looked into something, or just telling them they're doing a good job because you know that they are. To making an actual phone call and inquiring about something in your community, for your family, for a friend, for something else, for something globally, to getting on your bicycles, getting in the car, getting on the bus or walking to find wherever your local legislative office is, district office is, introducing yourself as a member of the community, and then engaging them in whatever dialogue you want to engage them in, but letting them know that you are a voting constituent in their district, in their community, and that you have concerns or you have thoughts or you have well wishes that you'd like to express to them. That's participating in the process of government. That's participating in this notion of you have a stake in the process. You have, what do we call it, skin in the game. You have skin in the game and you want to make sure that they know who you are and that you are going to hold them accountable for what it is that they say they're going to do for you as an individual and as a community. Participatory. 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 All right, I know you've heard enough of me harping on that particular situation. That gets into the role of the people. But before we get there, I talk about us as a society. I talk about us as the greater whole, or I talk about benefiting the greater whole. I talk about us, I've used the term citizen. What exactly does that mean? Who are citizens? What is a citizen? Let's take a look at this clip and come back at me with your thoughts on what is a citizen, or who is a citizen, who is not a citizen? And let me know what you're thinking.
It means you're part of something basically bigger than yourself.
You gotta follow the laws. Pay my taxes on time.
Follow the rules.
Being a citizen kind of gives you a voice.
You have to vote.
No matter what state you're in, whether it's red or blue.
There is no such thing as a small election.
You have to be active.
Be aware of what's happening within your community
and really trying to figure out what your community needs.
It means being a good neighbor, watching out for one another.
Be as nice as possible.
Taking care of the environment.
Decreasing our carbon footprint.
An ideal citizen is someone who is an informed member of a society.
Educating yourself.
If you want to be a good citizen, be of service, be of service, and be of service.
Go into that community and give your time. Your time is so valuable.
We all need to play a part.
I think a good citizen is someone that sees an issue or a problem or believes in something and kind of goes for it and makes the environment and the community that they're in a much better place to be a part of.
It began with my parents, who are both very, you know, informed, civic-minded people.
My parents are amazing citizens.
My father is a veteran, and he inspired me to always be kind and caring.
It was definitely my parents and my teacher.
I was taught in school that to be a good citizen is what the Constitution requires.
I think people who devote their kind of careers to service inspire me.
Growing up, volunteering was a part of our family.
My parents were immigrants, so they actually came to New York, and they always had that sense of wanting to belong somewhere, and, you know, they would always take me to volunteer places, and that's a tradition I'd like to continue.
That's a tough one.
I don't think a lot of people see themselves as citizens anymore. I think a lot of people see themselves as consumers.
What schools have civic courses anymore?
The most important thing is to lead by example.
Lead by example is always good.
It's just going out and showing the world that it's very simple to just give back.
It's incumbent upon government leaders and business leaders to make it easy for people and give them turnkey solutions to be of service to their community.
People need to feel secure, and they need enough free time to be civically engaged.
This generation is particularly focused on social media.
That is how teenagers now communicate.
So figuring out how to ways to incorporate social networking into creative ways of solving the big problems in the world.
Those of us who are engaged have to make it a point to take other people with us.
Parents, teachers have a huge influence.
Reaching out to the next generation to teach them why it's important.
The youth are willing to serve.
Once you do a service project or a volunteering project, you really get that sense of, hey, you know, this feels good inside, and I want to do more of this.
If you get out there and get involved, you'll find it's so much more enriching, it's so much more powerful.
Do something to make a change.
Do something to actually make a difference.
Okay, so, I don't know, did that one resonate with you guys? Being a citizen is an important responsibility. Understanding what your contribution to the community and to society and to yourself is very important. To figure what that looks like, figure out what that looks like or what that feels like means that you have to put yourself out there to actually take part. I'm a very big advocate on community engagement, civic engagement, and it's perilous that we have lost the opportunity to do civic education in so many of our schools. It really starts, this idea of wanting to participate and do something for not just yourself, but for others, starts when you're very young. And if you don't nurture that throughout your life, you become self-centered and it's just about you. Well, we can't function in a society in that way, at least not here in the U.S. You might be able to swim somewhere else off the shores of one of our coasts and go somewhere else where that is allowable or the ideal state. But we need citizen participation. We need you to figure out what that looks like for yourself and then to pay it forward. This is my way of paying it forward. I grew up understanding that you had to give back to the community that you grew up in. And so I grew up not too far from here in my older youth days, I guess my teen days. I come from a military family. My father was in the service. And so we grew up all over the world. And I have an appreciation of what it's like to live in different places where you don't always have the same thing that we take for granted here in the U.S. Being able to voice your opinions and your thoughts may not necessarily have been the okay thing to do in some places where I've lived. I've grown up across the United States of America at different military bases, in different parts of different regions of the United States, where it wasn't always the best to voice my concerns. I follow in my father's footsteps as far as being a political advocate. I have been very involved in political campaigns because I feel it's my responsibility to become educated, informed, and aware of the issues that surround me. And then what is my little piece that I can give or do to affect somebody else's life or some other situation within our society? So community engagement, For my on-campus students, when I teach political science on the campus or public administration, they are engaged in community engagement, civic learning opportunities, service learning opportunities to give back to the community, and that is part of the curriculum that we work through by semester. So I am a big advocate on that. It starts with you, the individual, and figuring out what you can do to better society or better yourself. Sarah says this particular video resonated with her immensely. She said, being a citizen means participating in the community. A citizen must give back to the community. I feel that many people today do not see themselves so much as citizens, but as more of individuals who do not give back. They do things that benefit only themselves and not society as a whole. And Sarah, thank you so much for your comments. I appreciate that. And I believe there are many people, and I think it came out in the video, that would share your perspective. Generations by generation contribute different things to our society. And as I said before, I grew up watching TV in German with subtitles at the bottom in English. We didn't have, it wasn't translated in English for us. So I learned to speak German, but understanding that, and then when I came to the US, I learned to speak Spanish. Understanding that it's our responsibility to do something. And back when I was coming up, I had typewriters. I know y'all don't know what a typewriter is, but I had a typewriter. I wrote things out in pen and pencil on paper. I didn't have computers. We didn't have computers back in the day. They weren't invented back then. Now, I don't go all the way back to the wagon train and, you know, the pioneer days and all that good stuff. But I've had my share of watching generations change and how they adapt to the things that they're able to control for themselves and the things that they let go by the wayside. Because of the technology that we have today, people are becoming more about themselves and isolated from the greater whole and not becoming a part of it. And social media, I'm sorry, does not take care of all the social ills and the social injustices that happen in our society. You can't just sit there and text it all and tweet it all and Instagram it all and Facebook it all. And as you can tell, some of that has gotten us into trouble. And you guys are going to see some of that in a couple of assignments and videos that we have coming up in the next couple of weeks. Did we have a caller on the line? Okay, I'll wait to get back to that. Okay, one of the elements of this course is an extra credit opportunity. And so every week I'm going to give out an extra credit question, and then it'll be up to you to respond to that question. So here's my question. I don't know if we have it up on the screen yet. Should it be possible to lose one's citizenship under any circumstances? So ponder that when we just talked about citizens and what that means to be a citizen. Citizens, again, are members of a political community, having both rights and responsibilities, which include the fact that we have to obey laws, we have to pay taxes, we can own businesses, and we participate in government if we choose to, but we have the option to do that. So that's what a democratic citizen, in our democratic system, that's what that's how people are viewed as being citizens. So my question to you earlier was, who is a citizen, who is not? I see that we do have a caller on the line, so I'll go ahead and take the call. And this is Olivia from Orange County. Hi, Olivia.
Hi. I like to make a comment on being a participant. I've always gone to the polls with my parents and to vote, and I can't wait until I can vote myself.
That's awesome.
My parents never miss an election, and I think it's very important if I want my city, state, or country to do better.
Absolutely. So how far away are you from being able to exercise your opportunity to vote, to register to vote?
Only a year.
Another year?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you continue to get informed about the issues that are surrounding you and the things that are of interest to you so that when you get to the polls, just like your parents have been teaching you, you'll be more educated and informed about what it is that you want to make decisions about.
Yeah.
I applaud you, sweetie. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. So just as Olivia said, I can tell you that I have three grandchildren, and my daughter and son-in-law take the boys to every election, and they live in Charleston, South Carolina now. They take them to every election so that they can be a part of the process, and they also know that their grandmother is a big proponent of that. But they're teaching them, just like Olivia's parents are doing, about the process that is afforded to us as citizens in this particular society, in our democratic society. All right, so back with the question about who's a citizen, who is not, I had another video clip that I wanted you guys to see real quick. So if we could put that one up, and then we'll go into some of what it is that we believe as citizens in this society.
There are a few ways to legally become a U.S. citizen, but the absolute easiest way is to be born here. That is literally all you need to do. Your parents don't have to be American. You don't have to be raised in America. You don't even have to stay in the United States. You just have to be born on U.S. soil. And as a result of this, the current ease of global travel and the rise of new economies in places like South Korea, Turkey, Taiwan, and China, to name a few, a booming birth tourism industry now exists. Pregnant women are coming to the U.S. for the exclusive purpose of giving birth and obtaining U.S. citizenship for their child. And as I said, this is totally legal. So how did we get here? Well, the question of who can and cannot become a U.S. citizen has been a hotly debated topic since the beginning of our nation. We're going to try and stay out of that argument while giving you some history on the issue. The U.S. started with a very strict citizenship policy that only enabled land-owning white men to become citizens. This policy has since changed drastically, with restrictions on citizenship widening and tightening based on the cultural climate at the time. For example, in 1790, they widened the citizenship base by dropping the landowning requirement and allowing white males to become citizens after living in the country for only 2 years. This was in response to a large increase in non-landowning white males. Then, through legislation in 1795 and 98, they tightened citizenship laws by requiring that people live in the United States for at least 14 years in order to gain citizenship. This was in response to a sudden influx of European immigrants from Germany, Ireland, and Scotland. The law allowing citizenship by birth didn't exist prior to the passing of the 14th Amendment in 1868. It was passed as a way to guarantee citizenship to African Americans and their children. This was done in the wake of the Civil War and the abolition of slavery. Citizenship by birth started as a simple legal way to enfranchise the enormous population of African Americans that had previously been restricted from citizenship because of their skin color, a problem the United States does not have today. So why are we not tightening our citizenship laws again? We aren't doing so because the United States has an enormous and permanent illegal immigrant population, and addressing the problem of birth tourism also means addressing immigration reform. Not something many lawmakers feel like taking on right now.
All right, so we're going to get into that conversation around immigration reform. And I believe one of your journal opportunities is about the position that President Obama is taking or has taken on the issue of immigration. And there are lots of conversations and discussions around the idea of immigration reform in the 21st century versus what it looked like in the 20th century, well before many of you guys were born. But something needs to change. And I think many people will agree what that change looks like might be different from different perspectives or different ideologies, which is one of the areas that we're going to get into in a minute. But again, what is a citizen and who is not? If immigrants come here legally on a permanent resident visa, well, that looks a little bit different than if you come in here, if you come to the United States illegally. There are rules and regulations that you follow if you come here seeking, if you come here on a legally on a resident visa, and you follow those rules and regulations and you do what the agency has indicated you need to do to secure citizenship, which is a very long, arduous, and very broad process. But if you do all of that, then you become a citizen through the process of what we call naturalization. The other side of that is if you enter illegally, and the concerns or the issues from a societal standpoint that many people will weigh in on over time and have presents a whole different set of circumstances. I'm not sure if you've seen on the news lately, and I think it's one of your another one of your assignments that you have to do around the law that was passed effective January 1st of this year, that individuals who are here in California illegally will have the opportunity to secure a driver's license. And so what used to be a 45 minute to an hour and 15 minutes, hour and a half visit to the Department of Motor Vehicles, otherwise known as the DMV, could be anywhere from a 4-hour, 6-hour field trip to handle your business, no matter what your business is or who you are, because of the increased number of individuals since January 2nd who have gone to the DMV to secure their licenses so that they can drive legally in the state of California. From a government standpoint and from a legislative standpoint, folks are asking, did we really take into consideration all of the everything that we needed to be able to accommodate that particular law that went into effect on January the 1st? And what is the impact to residents or citizens or individuals in the state of California who are here both legally or illegally? So you do have that as one of your journal assignments, I believe, and watching an actual news clip of the coverage on that particular situation for you to give me your feedback individually. But those are the kinds of issues that we talk about when people are trying to figure out, well, who's a citizen and who's not? Who determines what a citizen is and what a citizen is not? Okay, so what do we or what do citizens in America actually believe? What are we about? What are we thinking? What are some of the perspectives, opinions, ideologies that we possess as individuals? Well, we share a common political culture in America, common values and beliefs that kind of pull us together, draw us together because we have something in common. The U.S. political culture then emphasizes procedural guarantees and individualism. So while we're part of a collective as a society, we still retain our own individualism, which is a good thing. The idea that individuals know what is best for themselves. And a lot of people will say, well, government thinks they know what's best for us. But we still retain the right to know what's best for us. Whether or not we conform to what government says is a whole nother matter. The core values of American culture, there are three main core values that we're going to talk about today. Democracy, freedom, and equality. So they're all defined through procedural or individualistic lens. So if you look at them like if you're looking through a telescope and you can see what democracy might look like to you, and then you take another look through the camera lens and you see what equality might represent or look like to you. And then you can look through the same lens or maybe a different lens or shape, change it a little bit and see what freedom might look like to you as an individual. So how do we look different? What is it that we are thinking? Do ideological differences strengthen or weaken our political culture? Some of the things that feed into who we are as citizens and what we believe outside of those three values, and your textbook gets more into what those three values actually include, which I will in a second. There's a video that I want you guys to watch, but before we go to that particular video, I want to talk about this term called ideologies, which is also can be aligned with perspectives. All right, what are some examples of this ideology? What does it mean? Well, within the context of the shared political values that we as citizens have in our political culture, we also have divergent beliefs, values, and perspectives. We call those ideologies about political and economic affairs. And remember, at the beginning of our class this afternoon, we talked about in the video, the first video you saw, how politics and economics go hand in hand here in the United States. So you can't really do one without the other. One impacts the other, this one impacts this one impacts this one. So you can't move without involving both of those pieces. Generally though, these ideologies are referred to as you're either conservative or you're liberal, okay? And we can be very specific around what conservative means versus what liberal means. And when people first think of conservative, I don't know what you think about, but others have said, it reminds them of the Republican Party and the position and ideology that those who are part of the Republican Party represent, the things that they stand for, versus those who are involved on the Democratic side. It reminds them from the liberal standpoint of what perhaps a Democratic idealist or individual who has specific ideals would consider to be liberal. Depending on their views about government and the economy in establishing social order, most of us can be defined as one of the following. We're either economic liberals, we're economic conservatives, we are perhaps libertarians, which is part of either the economic liberals or the economic conservatives. We could be social liberals. We could be, and within the social liberals are, includes communitarians and social conservatives. So what does all that mean? What do we mean by all of that? Well, the political culture that I initially talked about just a minute ago, we have a two-party system in the U.S., in the United States of America. Our government system is a two-party political system. It's hard for either party to maintain the support of a majority when our thoughts, our opinions, our perspectives, our ideologies are so diverse. So I gave you the example of when people think of Republicans being conservative, and then they think of Democrats being liberal, and you have the picture in the background there of what their, symbols have a powerful impact in our thinking process. But anyway, what those two mean. So political culture refers to the general political orientation or disposition of a given nation or a country. The shared values and beliefs about the nature of that particular political world that give us something that we have in common, a common language that we can dialogue through, in which we discuss and debate political issues or ideas. So this notion of values, we have beliefs and values, we have individualism. So what does it mean to have values, or what does the term values mean in this context? Values are our ideals or our principles that most people agree are important to themselves, even though we have the opportunity to disagree because we don't exactly align with what somebody else might be thinking, such as equality or freedom, and how that ought to be defined. So we have different perspectives, different ideas about the term equality, different perspectives and ideas around the term of freedom. Who should have it, who shouldn't have it, what it should look like, how much they should have, how much they shouldn't have. But we can agree to disagree. We don't always have to agree on the same thing. That's what gives us such a richness in this society, and being able to have those conversations and walk away with, if we don't have full agreement, the ability and opportunity to agree, we disagree. All right, and then from that, we have individualism, which is your own personal belief and value system. So I myself have my own personal belief and value system. People that I'm around have theirs, and I'm sure that as students and individuals, members of the society, you have your own. So individualism is an important element in our democratic society here in the United States. Other countries do not have that option to be individual. They don't have the option of the value of their own belief system is not necessarily valued by the individuals that are leading them through their government structure. One thought came to mind, which was the country of China. And many, many years ago, well before you guys were even born, Tiananmen Square, where the individual students spoke up about things that they wanted to change. They wanted things in their society, in their government, in their communities, in their lives to be different than what they were. And they protested and took a stand. And one of their common squares for meeting places and took a stand against the government to be able to have the right to express themselves If you ever have a chance to go back and look on YouTube, maybe you can find a couple of video clips around that. If I can find some, I'll share them with you as we go through this process. But they had an idea of what their values and beliefs were as individuals, and they were taking a stand for that. And we see that through our right to protest and assemble. But it's very different when you have the right to do that, like we do in the U.S., versus a place like China where you don't have that right to just go out there and do that without expecting some kind of consequences as a result. And there were consequences. All right, so let's talk about the term democracy. In America, democracy, as I've said all through this afternoon, is representative democracy based on consent and majority rules. Freedom, from an ideological standpoint, freedom is defined as for the individual freedom from government, the restraint of the state on to you as an individual. Another term to consider is equality, considered the third central value of American political culture. And equality is valued not because we want individuals to be the same, to look the same, to think the same, to be the same. No, not equality of result, all right? America means, let me go back. Equality is valued not because we want individuals to be the same, but because we want them to be treated the same. I can go down the story when we get to civil rights about equality and treatment and fair treatment and things, and we'll travel down that road about what society looked like, what our country looked like. A long time ago, where equality was not the same for many of the minorities, immigrants who came here from other countries, as well as things that we've done to folks here in the United States through the years. And we will go down that road. But equality in America means government should guarantee equality of treatment, of access, of opportunity, and not the end result of equality as the result. For example, people should have the opportunity to run the race, but we don't all have to finish in the same place. We have an equal opportunity to run a race. The Boston Marathon, we're not all going to finish in the same place at the same time, but we have the opportunity to put on our shoes, put on our gear, put on our earplugs, and head out there and do our thing. And wherever we end up is where we end up, but that's our choice. All right. American ideologies that divide us. Yes, we do have some that divide us. We have a political party system, a two-party system. We have Democrats on one side, Republicans on another, and then we have a mixture of different parties in between. When we don't come together as a society, we have divisiveness. We have divisiveness in our government now. We've had divisiveness in our government structure over the decades, over the centuries. What does that do for us? Just because we share a political culture does not mean that we will not clash with ideals or opinions and thoughts of others. So we do this from time to time, and more often than not, it goes on for much longer than it should before coming to a resolution. One of the reasons we can agree or disagree so passionately is that the world is not black and white. It is not true and false. It is not good or bad. So we can do this notion of disagreeing or agreeing, okay? It's healthy to have opposing perspectives and viewpoints. Again, what would we all look like if we were cloned to be exactly the same, doing exactly the same thing at the same time, everywhere, all of us? Question, what would we look like as a society if we thought the same thoughts and acted upon them in the same exact manner? Well, we'd be in trouble. On page 27 of your text, it provides an illustration of the ideological beliefs that we share or have here in the United States. So when you have a few minutes, go back and look at page 27 of your text and look at the illustration. Moving over to page 29, then, you see the ideological placement of parties and groups in the U.S. around politics. So take a look at that as well, and that will help to answer my two questions that I posed to you around what society would look like if we all were the exact same and did exactly the same thing at the same time and ended up with the same or similar results. And then what kind of values do we place or what is the benefit of having differing ideologies in that we're not all doing the same thing at the same time? Okay, so I promised you a clip. I want you guys to go ahead and take a look at this clip and come back at me with your thoughts. I've talked to you about ideologies, economic liberals, conservatives, libertarians, some liberals, some communitarians, conservatives. So take a look at this and tell me, do ideological differences strengthen or weaken our political culture?
Political and culture and ideology are two different things. They're closely related. Let's define things first. Political culture is a widely held set of beliefs by all people within a polity. So thinking about American political culture, what are the things that all Americans can commonly agree about our politics or about our political system? A couple features of American political culture: a belief in liberty. People are free. They should be free. The government's there to protect freedom. Individualism, that people can solve the problems on their own. They're not always reliant on government to solve problems. Equality of opportunity more so than equality of result. And that's kind of there's a conflict between equality and liberty. Like, how do you give people complete freedom when knowing that freedom sometimes can create winners and losers? And how do you also give people kind of equal access to the riches of the country or of the resources of the country while still not restricting their freedom? So that conflict is played out every day in politics at every level of government in the United States. We have a belief in democracy, that citizens control the agenda, civic duty, people have a responsibility to each other and to the polity, a distrust in government, that government's really not going to be successful at solving problems, that people will. Political efficacy is defined as knowing what you can do politically to create change and then being able to do that and then doing that, effectively creating that change. So it's the knowledge of knowing how to use the political system and then using the political system to your advantage is political efficacy. Very few people have high political efficacy. How many of us think that we really can change the government effectively? Political tolerance, pragmatism, get the job done, and a belief in justice. Now, ideology is something a little bit more specific than culture.
Okay, so that just gave you an idea of some of our, what kinds of elements are included in our political culture. And the list goes on. So we all have something to say, I'm pretty sure, about each one of those in some way or another. Or you will, as time goes on, as you learn more about society, government, civics, and our responsibilities as individuals to be informed about government and politics and values, ideologies, norms. So who are conservatives? They're people who fit this profile. They tend to be in favor of traditional social values. Again, they distrust government action, except in matters of national security, which is very important. And they're slow to advocate change. Everything is good enough, status quo, leave it alone, don't make any changes, I'm not ready for it, don't do it, everything's working just fine. And they place a high priority on the maintenance of social order. Liberals are the opposite of that. So in sharp contrast, they place the values of possibilities of progress, moving forward, and change. They have a trust in government. It, depending on what's happening at the time, it might be a very tight trust. It could be a lucid trust. They look for innovations as answers to social problems, and they focus on the expansion of individual rights and the opportunity of individual rights with expression. So the main differences between these two different profiles that I've shared with you, conservatives and liberals, are, well, it focuses on the economic perspectives and ideas and views between the two. Economic liberals, for instance, they're willing to allow government to make significant, substantive decisions about the economy. They tend to embrace the top procedural individualistic portion of the social order dimensions, which is found actually in figure 1.1 on page 10 of your text. So if you want to take a look at that diagram, that'll help show you the order in which they approach their understanding. As far as government regulations of individuals' private lives is concerned, liberals favor a hands-off approach, preferring that individuals have maximum freedom over their non-economic affairs. Then you have economic conservatives. They share their liberal counterparts' tolerance around the reluctance to allow government interference in people's private lives, but they also combine this with the conviction that government should limit their involvement in the economy as well. So respect individual rights and freedoms, and it's an opportunity to express, but also limit what the government can do or should be doing as far as their involvement in the economy. Libertarians, on the other side of that, represent the most extreme perspectives of economic conservative views. So these folks are people who believe only minimum government action in any sphere is acceptable. As economic conservatives, libertarians also hold the government accountable for sticking to the constitutional checks and balances as a way to ensure its power. Social liberals, well, they're happy to see some government action to realize substantive vision of what society would actually look like or should be like. Communitarians have a strong commitment, of course, as a root word, community. Community based on radical equality of all people. And then the other side of communitarians are social conservatives, and these people share the viewpoint of economic conservatives on limited government as it relates to the economy, but with less force and perhaps for different reasons. Okay, so question that I have for you. What are the challenges, or what do you perceive to be the challenges in reading your text and understanding the text? Maybe you can share that with me. Does it matter to the success of a democracy if relatively few people take an active political role, which is very important? My perspective, my thoughts, my opinion. So maybe you can share that with me. I need to hear your answer. Sarah and Olivia have been great responding to me today. Appreciate that from both of you. I have a lot of you in this class. So if you have thoughts, ways to earn your participation points is by engaging with me. And you can do that through multiple forums that I've shared with you. I'd love to hear from you. Answers to some of the questions that I've posed already. Love to hear them. Love to hear your thoughts and your perspectives. Okay, I promised you that I would go through the syllabus. Let me see where I left off on. Yes. Back to the question that I had for you on the challenges of the textbook. So what makes critical thinking feel like so much more than regular thinking? And as you delve into the text, there are a couple of things that I want you to consider, because critical thinking is very important. You have to develop that, and hopefully I'm going to help you with that as we move through this process. But there were three particular questions that I had written down for you that I wanted you to consider as you start this process of critically thinking through politics and government in our society. So here they go. Oh, I left out a whole section that I wanted to cover. You want to analyze American politics by asking these three particular questions. Who are the parties involved? What do they have at stake? And in each one of the chapters in this textbook, there is a what is at stake conversation, a dialogue of something that has happened. And we want to know what's at stake from a citizen perspective, from a government perspective. What are the results and the outcome from what happened? From what happened to the end result of what should have happened or what might have happened or the end result of what did happen. And then the third question is, how do the rules shape the outcome? Again, going back to what's at stake. So as you think through reading the material in the course, listening to me talking, watching the internet clips, videos that we have each week, reading some of the content that I have for you in the articles that are listed or the videos that are actually on the website, you have to think about those three questions as you approach the notion of, well, what is this about? Why does this exist this way? So I want you to think about that, and as it relates to the difference between critical thinking and regular thinking. I'm not sure what regular thinking is, but hopefully I've given you an idea about how to dig deeper, think deeper than just surface level thinking. You got to dig in and find out, well, why is this happening this way? Who's in control? Why are people letting this be the way it is? Or, wow, this is the greatest thing since sliced bread. I'm so glad I'm part of this society. Think about it. Okay, so one of the other questions that I had or comments that I had around this is from the different ideologies that I just shared with you, from those different labels and giving you an explanation of what they mean from a societal norm, some of the primary concern is around the idea that, again, we can all differ and we can all agree, but somewhere along the way, that's not going to be our reality, and it isn't. The goal of this book is to teach critical thinking about American politics through the tools of analysis and evaluation. I want to make sure that we are able to analyze how American politics works through the framework of our definition of politics. I've given you my definition. The textbook has a definition. You, as you live life, will have your own definition. And from socialization, which we'll get into in a couple of weeks, how you're socialized politically, you'll glean a definition from that or formulate one from that. Who gets power and resources and how they get them? And then we'll evaluate how well American politics works by focusing on the opportunities and challenges of citizenship. So hopefully today I've shared some of that with you. Food for thought for you is to go back and make sure that you read the material in this chapter. And then you start reading going forward, as each week you have what's called a pre-broadcast quiz. You will need to complete. It's a series of 7 to 8 questions that you'll need to answer. And in order to answer them correctly, you'll need to read the chapters. They're all related to content in the chapters. So there are points associated with that. You want to earn the maximum points you can to get the grade that you want. You need to do the work. So I'm going to do it on my end. I need you to do it on your end. To that end, let me just tell you that along with those pre-broadcast quizzes, which your first one will open up on Thursday of this week, and every time we have a pre-broadcast quiz, it will open at noon on Thursdays and it will close at 7 p.m. on Sundays. So keep that in mind. The one that you have coming up, the very first one that you have coming up, will open up on this Thursday, and it will be for 2 chapters, chapters 2 and chapter 3. So you need to get the textbook, you need to get into the reading. If you have groups that you can work with at school to get the reading done, I encourage you to do that. However, test taking is your own individual effort, and that is spoken to in the syllabus as well, so make sure that you read that. Scholar introductions on Blackboard. I need you to go into Blackboard to the discussion board and introduce yourselves. I need you to tell me, answer the questions that are listed in there and any additional information you want to share so that we can get to know each other over the course of the next 13 weeks. You have to have that done by 7 p.m. on Wednesday night. Journal write, yep, it's like homework, but it's a quick write, what I call a quick write, 100 words. You have a quick write that is due by 7 p.m. on Wednesday, so you need to go into the section that's called journals and look and see what the quick write is for this week. Again, the best thing and the best approach that you can take is to pay attention to the documents that are in Blackboard. Become familiar with Blackboard. It's important that you check your emails periodically. I mean, more than periodically. Periodically not meaning once a week. You need to be up to date on anything that I might send out, which includes announcements. You need to look at Blackboard for announcements, course changes, updates, anything that I might put out there for you. I will notify you in advance, and then you can go ahead and take a look at it. If there's something out there that you need clarification on or understand a better understanding of, you need to come back to me with what your questions are. I do not accept work by email, so please do not send me assignments or anything that's already posted in Blackboard as a deliverable. Don't send that to me on an email. It just isn't going to happen. And then in order for you to correspond with me, to get through this class, there's a phone number in there for you to contact me. There's our office number to contact me. There's also an email address. There are two email addresses associated with Professor Riddick. One is listed in your syllabus, and that's the only one that you should be using to contact me. If you use the other one, I'll never see it. I promise you, it'll never get to me. Please use the correct one, and that way we can ensure that I answer your questions in a timely manner, and we can have that dialogue back and forth to address any concerns that you have. All right, what other things that I want to tell you before we wrap up our class session today? Please, please, please read the syllabus. Okay, next week we'll be talking about Chapter 2, which is on the Constitution, and Chapter 3, which is on federalism. So in the weekly course outline that I've provided for you, you will see that each one of the weeks tells you exactly what we'll be talking about as it relates to the chapters in the textbook and questions that I may bring up or questions that you should consider as you critically think about this work. Then on the end of the weekly outline, there is the weekly broadcast quiz schedule. Please pay attention to that. If you miss a broadcast, pre-broadcast quiz, there is no makeup for that. You also have a midterm that will be available to you in about 6 weeks. Information is on Blackboard related to that, and you have a cumulative final exam, and that information is also posted. So please make sure that you follow your course syllabus accordingly. It's been great. I appreciate it. I look forward to hearing from all of you this next week and ongoing around anything related to politics. Think critically as you ask. Genesia. Critical thinking differs from regular thinking because it incorporates the why value. I love it. Apart from the regular statement, critical thinking is an analyzation on a deeper level and understanding. In the way, critical thinking is the thinking behind the thinking. I love it. Thank you. Thank you guys so much. And with that, I will see you next week. Thank you.